Welcome back to yet another dynamic season of Open Space. First of all, give a hand clap of applause for yourselves for being back in place and space. So happy to be here with all of you. We've experienced so much. We've experienced both viral and racial pandemic. You know, we've been sheltering at home. And throughout all of that, you know, you tuned in with us last season. You came and hung out with us for 10 episodes. You drove us forward. You pushed us to interrogate new things. And now we are here, back with season two, with a dynamic group of people. Usually I'll pass it over to somebody else, but this time I'm the host. So I'll pass it over to myself just to give a little bit of housekeeping. Please make sure that you keep your video off and yourselves on mute. We will have a section a little bit later for you all to join in. In advance of that, you know, please use that chat. If you're at home on Facebook, please use that comment section. We would love to hear from you. We want you to be very much part of the conversation. With that, I want to get into just listening and hearing and learning more about our dynamic panel of guests. Denise, Saunders Thompson, President and CEO of the International Association of Blacks in Dance. How are you feeling today?
Toran, I'm feeling good today. Okay. It's sunny. It's weather's changing. I'm good. Thank you.
Okay. You know, look, I see, Francine over there, you know, she popped in with a little virtual background. She stole my, you know, but usually I do a virtual background, but this time she's got it. Francine, chime in with us. How you feeling today?
I am feeling excited. Oh, I am so glad for season two. I'm so glad to be here. Usually, you know, I'm a host and anxiety comes with that. Being a guest, I'm free. It feels good. I'm ready to talk.
All right, and to round us out, Kristopher McDowell, how you feeling? I know you're usually in some conference in some other country, but I'm so glad you made some time for us.
Oh my God, are you kidding? This is, I live for this at the moment, and I've missed it so much. I'm really excited for this conversation in particular, but I'm actually doing a virtual conference in Korea from 4 a.m. to 8 a.m. Central Time. So I'm happy to have a second wind by seeing you and thinking about what we're about to embark upon in this conversation.
Fantastic. I thought with this season opener that we go a different direction. I thought, you know, we don't often get to hear behind the minds behind some of our, you know, our works. I thought, why not hear from the people who help bring us all into this space, this open space, and help create it? You know, this partnership that we derived and came up with happened so uniquely. So I kind of want to jump in there. You know, I want to talk about how you all came about this partnership, like Open Space. Why now? Like everybody's doing virtual programming. What sets Open Space aside? Kristopher, I'm actually going to start with you because I remember that first email came with a KMFD at the front. So I want to hear from you. What was your idea in coming to both of our wonderful partners? I'm looking at Francine and Denise with their fine selves. How did you think to come to them about this project?
Without going too far back, there are realizations that I had from a mutual board that Denise and I sat on together. And it had been resonating with me from attending the IABD conference festival in Philadelphia that we needed to start engaging the conversation on a wider level. And it was percolating in my mind in the onset of the pandemic. I have to tell you, it was a little selfish. It was a little bit like, I really want to know what's happening in that community because of the pandemic. And I feel welcomed and I feel like this has been a portal to that. And I think more people should pay attention to that portal being open.
I love to hear it. I love hearing about opening those portals. We know, you know, everything is kind of, you know, it's a give and take, right? So even with that ask, there had to be a yes on the other side to really get us into this programming. And now I'm looking at Denise and Francine, like, what made you all say yes to this? What really pulled you in and be like, I'm willing to take a bet on this project?
What made me say yes is that I was sitting in my apartment during this pandemic, asking myself, what's next? How am I going to survive in this pandemic? And knowing that no live performance was happening anywhere, I had to figure out what I was going to do next. And Kristopher had approached me and asked if I would partner with open space. And at first I didn't really quite understand the whole concept of it. And then he said he was bringing in Denise and IABD, and I was like, oh, okay, this is something that I could get behind. And just with IABD's support and bringing this forward really gave me the confidence to just dive in and be a part of it. And it was so reassuring to have that support to do that. Because when Kristopher came to me, I was thinking, how are us, the two of us, was going to pull this off, really? And when he said he was going to bring in Denise, or Denise had already been like in the conversations, I was like, oh, okay, well, this is good, because Denise, she's a boss. She knows how to get stuff done. So this is definitely happening. So I was like, yeah, I'm all in.
Denise is such a boss. She happens to also be my boss. But Denise, you are the last piece of this puzzle. So I want to hear from you. Why open space? What was it for you that really brought you into this?
Really, it was you all, the staff. You know, we were having conversations about our programming. And we had been talking about doing some programming that brought us into the virtual space, right? We had just been in Los Angeles, remember, Toran? And we interviewed the last stop before the COVID hit. We had interviewed Charmaine Jefferson. And, you know, we were kind of already entering the space. So when Kristopher approached me about working together, I was like, you know what? And I mean, I told you all this. I was like, let's hop on this now. This might be, you know, another avenue, another way for us to create and work collaboratively with other folks, other agencies, with the work that we were already planning to do. So it was really a natural fit, and it just kind of catapulted us a little bit faster than we had thought we would go, but here we are. So it was a no-brainer for me. And, you know, I give credit to the staff of IABD, absolutely.
Shout out to the dynamic staff. I see some of them in the room and some of them not in the room, but I want to send much love to everybody on the IABD staff. You know, I always feel uplifted by them, and I always, you know, and we couldn't make this program possible without their help. Some of them are even actively supporting the program today. So I just want to give that little bit of flowers to you all in advance. With open space, in thinking about it, it represents something that's happening largely in the field. We're witnessing this change in models of operation, change in programming, changing how people are really analyzing and looking at how they interact with the field. You all, you know, all of the conferences, being in all of the conversations, how do you think that the industry forges ahead? Like, how do you think that we're gonna create these new models? You know, anybody can take that. I'm actually gonna throw it to Francine first.
Well, we are actually forming new models as we speak. Kristopher and I are in partnership with another company called Rhizome Arts Consulting, and we really wanted to change the model of what arts artists, representatives look like. We want to change the name of, or the title that we give ourselves as agents, because that really represents, for us, the word agent represents a transactional thing. And we really want what we do to be more relationship. We want to have those relationships with presenters and funders, and especially with our artists. We don't want it to just be transactional and not have any kind of human connection to any part of what we do. So with Rhizome, which is an artist consulting company, we wanted to use our rosters combinedly. We wanted to just combine the two rosters together to create more of an outreach, or more of a reach, I should say, not outreach, but just a reach to different presenters, and position our artists strategically, so that when things open up again, who knows when that will be, we're ready to go. And we have from this point on, we have created relationships with these presenters. So it's not just, oh, once the gates open, the floodgates open, we're trying to vie for somebody's attention. We are already engaging them in that way so that they know what we are bringing is genuine. And with that, we are also digging into changing the mindset of different organizations, of arts organizations. We really want to be able to change their mindset and dismantle racism within those organizations. We want to be able to change language for the funders on how they see or how they adjudicate applications, how they really change the wording and look at dance in particular in a different lens. So we are out to advocate for that. So what we're doing is a little bit different than what normal agencies do, but we are really looking to help change the face of that and also include other fields. We're looking at startups, we're looking at commercial places. We're trying to really weave the arts through every aspect of life.
Wow, that's amazing. And if you're in the audience, you know, send them a fire emoji, because that's amazing work that you all are taking on. Like, that's insane. Something that you brought up was about kind of social justice and challenging the system. And I'm looking at Denise, since she's such an expert wordsmith, because she kind of went hard at the system this time around, especially when COVID and everything happened. We talk about the Can You Hear Me Now campaign. Denise, you really kind of brought the industry and a lot of professionals to task with that. Can you talk to us about that?
Yep. You know, I mean, literally today, on a call, the systems have to change. The systems have to change. If we don't change the way, just as Francine articulated, the way we are doing business, we are going to continue unequitable inequities. No access, it will be the same. This time in our lives is critical. This is like the moment, right? This is like, if this is the time you're gonna be present and you wanna do something, you need to put your mind to it. And so the Can You Hear Me Now campaign really called the white American dance community to task, to really look inside, in depth, at the practices, the procedures, the models, the modes of operation. And it was, you know, our community saying, enough is enough. We see you, as the theater community says, we see you, and change has to happen. We can no longer operate in this form or this fashion. And so it was just really bluntly saying it, you know, no sugarcoating, because I think, yes, we can all be wordsmiths. And, you know, I sometimes, we all do it when we're writing our grants and everything else, trying to figure out how we say what we need to say without hurting or offending everyone. Mm-mm. This time, I think it was really, you know, the, come on now, really, you know, the eyes and the neck and the head roll and all of it all in one. The little sharp edge to say, come on, people, this enough is enough. And so, you know, we called out our community. We called out our ballet companies. We called out our critics. Called out academicians. We called out the scholars, the folks, the journalists, everyone. This is enough. Come on. If we really are about what we say we are, and we are in this movement of equity, inclusion, diversity, social justice, racial justice, all of these things, our actions must speak louder than the words. And the words, when they started coming out in those statements, were empty. because there was no action behind them. We can say all that we want to say, you know, that saying you can talk to people till they're blue in the face. Okay, that's enough. Where's the action behind it? And so I think now there's a reckoning that's happening in our community. And it's layered on top of all of these other crises and this pandemic that's currently happening. I was on a call yesterday and we were talking about, you know, the playing field being even. It's not quite even yet because we haven't seen the system change. When we see the system change, then we can talk about the playing field actually being even or accessible in ways that we never could have imagined. I shared today with the staff, I was doing some scrolling on the internet, that San Francisco is testing a new model and they are paying their artists $1,000 a month. That's innovation. That's testing. That's changing the system. That's what we're looking for. I mean, that's just one example. So yeah, Toran, we're not taking it anymore.
All right then. Well, you know, look, I live in Los Angeles. I might need to move a little further up in California. Give me a little second, third string of income here. With that actually brings us to our first game break. Of course, for those new to it, we play a game called Two Truths and a Lie, where we get to learn a little bit more about one of our guests. We do it throughout the series to, you know, keep a little bit of levity in there. We're actually going to start with the last person who spoke. So we're going to get to learn a little bit more about Denise Saunders Thompson. And we're going to go ahead and launch that poll. So if you're in the room, you know, after you hear those options, take that poll with us. If you're on Facebook, we'll drop those in the comment section. Denise Saunders Thompson says that she has an older brother that lives in Germany. Denise Saunders Thompson says that she has a younger brother who lives in Atlanta. Denise Saunders Thompson says that she has a dog named Charlie. Which one of y'all think, which one do you think is the lie? Go ahead and let us know via the poll. Go ahead and let us know via the comments out there in the Facebook world. We want to know which one y'all think is the lie. I don't even know if our fellow guests know.
Oh, this is funny.
I'm in the chat, okay.
All right.
Give y'all about
right, we need some music.
Right. Right. See, the free, look, we're gonna get it sponsored. Look, you know.
That's right. Right.
3 more seconds. All right. With that, the folks are saying Charlie was in the lead. Folks think the lie is that Denise has a dog named Charlie. Kristopher, Francine, which one do you think is the lie?
I said the brother in Atlanta.
Okay. Kristopher?
I said the brother in Germany.
Okay. Solid guesses. Denise, would you like to share with them which one is the lie?
The lie, 4 people got it right, that I have a dog named Charlie. His name is actually Pepper.
Good old Pepper.
Pepper.
You stick on a call long enough, you'll hear Pepper in the background.
That's right. But I do have two. I have an older brother and a younger brother. One is in Germany and the other is in Atlanta.
There you have it. Look, if you're looking for some of the, you know, that Saunders family, you know, it, like they're all over it. So we could check in wherever. I saw you, Aquel. I was like, Aquel be doing. Aquel be is master that chat. Aquel be doing his people. Love to see it. Thank y'all for enjoying that first game break with me. I know I definitely enjoy getting to know Denise a little better. Now, kind of piggybacking or, you know, continuing on in that idea of systemic change we were talking about. Kristopher, I'm looking at you because you operate in a lot of different markets and you have a lot of different conversations. I know through the Artist Connectivity series, you know, we've met people in the Middle East. We've talked to, you know, people in the People's Republic of China. You know, we're talking people in Latin countries. How are you seeing kind of that global systemic change happen as well?
So I do feel connected thanks to things like Zoom with international colleagues, but not being there physically in person makes a big difference. I feel like for the first time, I am more in touch with my own country than I have been for probably 11 years. And it's a very exciting time to be here for that. I guess what I want to say is, because I've been so entrenched, and Francine and I have been so entrenched for the last month in having conversations with arts presenters across North America, including Mexico, is a lot of confusion among presenters about what to do next, and work to empower the artists and the artistic companies to come up with things that are unique to them. What I am concerned about is there is this momentum to rush back to a return to what used to be in 22-23. So 22, end of fall into the spring season of 23. And there are sound bites out there in the marketplaces, in the conferences, about returning to only the big name companies, the big box office commercial things. And I understand that, but I also am concerned that we really think we know what's right for 22-23 right now. And I'm concerned about cash flow for artists and artistic companies over the next 18 months. And so how can we invest together in this moment? Funders, presenters, artistic companies, whatever Francine and I are calling ourselves now in terms of creative producers, managers, like, we got to go out and fundraise now. The change, I think, needs to happen at the center, which is the artists, and then it will ripple. So there, that confusion is warranted, and I think we need to be empowered by that and lead as a creative community. I don't know if I totally answered your question, but I'm sort of just summarizing what I'm hearing in the last month of these conferences that you talked about.
No, it's great. And you're giving me a great launch pad, because I think one of those things we talk about is money, right? So of course, due to COVID and the swift change that happened across the industry, where that people were no longer able to make money because they were not able to be in place and space. They had to rethink their models. They had to rethink presenting, right? They could not. People had to hop out of contracts. I think we talked about a lot in season one, right? That a lot of swift change happened, and that meant a lot of downfall, unfortunately, or like a downfall in season for people, not necessarily their companies. Pray the best to them. But I know that some people stepped up and took charge and tried to help that industry. One of those being IABD. So I'm looking back at Denise again, because we had the emergency fund emerge in that time as a way to kind of help bridge that gap until we can either find a new normal or find some way to heal the wound. So Denise, can you talk to us about that IABD emergency fund?
Yeah, Toran, the emergency fund was just critical and immediate help to our artistic community. And IABD, upon its founding, almost 30 years, I'm going to do a plug. We're going to be 30 in 2021. But 30 years ago, a fund was created to help in situations like this, when artists were having cash flow and or had emergencies to come up. And the organization was there back then to provide funding to those who were in need. Here we are again, 2020, in the middle of a pandemic and all of these crises, where the organization has been able to step in and provide critical to its community. And so the fund, we've been raising money from our friends, our foundations, our individual donors. Those who are part of the dance community have been giving to the fund, so that we are able to give immediately back to our artists and our organizations, so that they can continue to do the work that they need to do, even in, you know, this kind of archaic, I'll call it, form. I guess it's not archaic, it's innovative, but it's the mode of operation is so much, it's so much different in that thinking. But it's been here that we've been able to just provide that lifeline and no questions asked. It's a very simple process because we know people are already tasked with all the other things that are going on in their lives. We're just asking you to tell us just a little bit, and it's literally check the box, provide your bank account number, prove who you are, who you say you are, and if there's enough funding, first come, first serve, we're there, and we are providing those dollars, you know, to the community. So critical need, and we're trying to address it as best as we can.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, that is such a big help, I know, to many of the artists who are both on this platform and some who are not, some who are just out there in our Facebook watchers group. I'm looking at Francine now because Francine, you represent some of those artists, you know, who are out there in the field who have, you know, been on both sides, maybe been a beneficiary or just experienced something from, you know, the COVID-19. Can you kind of speak to how your artists are doing or how artists are, you know, kind of coping with this changing dynamic in the field?
Sure. Yeah. It wasn't an immediate shift or pivot, you know, we're saying those kind of words. But it really was a time for my artists to really reflect on their artistry and what they want to do with that artistry. And you know, it took some coaxing for some of my artists to enter into that virtual realm or that digital realm. And some of my other artists were already doing it. They were already doing it before the pandemic hit. So, you know, it was just a little bit of everything. But the main thing that I felt during this pandemic is that I was able to really connect with my artists. That was the thing that I really enjoy. I enjoy talking to my artists. I enjoy dreaming with them. I enjoy just doing those strategic things that we need to do to keep it moving forward. So some of them have received some money through NEA grants, through IABD, through other sources, and it's just much appreciated because they, you know, this is their living, this is their livelihood, this is how they make their money, this is how they support their family, you know. And it was devastating when everything pretty much stopped, you know. As an independent at that time, you know, I was an independent agent, and if my artists don't work, if they don't get paid, I don't get paid, you know. And that's how it was. It was really just that simple. All the contracts stopped, nothing was moving, and I had anticipated for Sheffield Global Arts Management to actually turn a profit this year, and it just stopped. You know, it just really, it was devastating. But now we are reimagining what art could look like in a digital form or, you know, on a virtual space. And it's exciting and scary at the same time. And we're still figuring it out. We're still figuring out how to afford it. How can we get money to afford equipment for this type of thing? You know, so we are still brainstorming on that. We are approaching other funders. How can we turn that presentation money into production money? How can we do that so that we can buy the equipment or rent the equipment to do what we need to do in that digital space, or how a presenter can invest in an artist to be able to do that work as well. So, you know, I'm trying to think outside the box with the help of Kristopher. You know, he has really been on the forefront of that, and he has invited me in, and now I'm able to really think, able to think and do in that space as well.
Wow, and I thank you for that. Like, I love that kind of symbiotic relationship there. You know, it's kind of all, you know, it's kind of all of us or none of us in that way. You know, like we're rising together or we're falling together. One of those things when I think about that is also the kind of impetus that's been being put on Black and Brown organizations and artists these days, right? The other side of the pandemic is that there's been a large focus on giving to them. You know, they've been renamed cultural treasures by some of our larger funders now, you know, even though they've always been valued amongst our community. However, you know, and I think we talked about this on our pre-call, you can give a lot of money to the, you can give a lot of money to people. That's a great band-aid, but that does not fix, you know, a broken system. So I'm kind of looking at Denise because we had, IABD had something, the Black Report, come out that really highlighted some of the, you know, those inequities in the field. Denise, can you talk to us about that?
So 2017, IABD was very fortunate to lock arms with the Mellon Foundation. And I truly mean that. We locked arms. Susan Fader, who is our program officer there, got us. She got us. And she wasn't scared to even learn more about us. And us, U.S. capital. Us. And the fact that this was an unprecedented move by the Mellon Foundation to support a volunteer-led dance service organization was just amazing. And so we went to work with the grant money we received from the Mellon Foundation. I traveled along with Baraka Saleh, who is our independent arts consultant, traveled to 15 different cities to visit our members for the first time in the 30-year history of IABD. So let's talk about inequities, right? Let's really talk about the work of service orgs and what we're really supposed to do. We never had the resources to do just that type of groundwork that is needed in servicing our own community. So in 2017, 2018, we got on the road and we went and interviewed 30 Black dance companies that were selected to be part of the Comprehensive Organizational Health Initiative, which we've now renamed MOVE, Managing Organizational Vitality and Endurance. Because that's what we've been doing, managing our organization's vitality and endurance for many, many years. There are organizations in our community that are 85 years old and older and have been sustaining and doing this work, and the staff will laugh when I say this, for decades, literally for decades. And so there were some myths about the stability of our community, about the contributions of our community, about how we're operating. And this report put those myths to shame and put them out of work, period. They're not true. This is what it really looks like. This is what the Black dance community really looks like. This is who is in it. Now, and this, how about this piece? This is the history that continues to be left out of the history books. I'll say this for the record. This world will not move without Black creativity, period, period. This world does not move without Black creativity. And this goes back centuries. We were brought here from our land and we built, y'all know you're ready to cuss, this
Oh my God, the tape machine.
But we built it. And what we built was taken from us, including the money. So when you talk about the cultural treasures, hell yeah, give the money back. Forget about granting. No, y'all took it. Like, let's be real. Okay, I know I'm going off for a minute. I'm on my soapbox. But I'm just, you know, like, this is real. These are people's lives. These are my ancestors. This is the reality that we are dealing with right now. That's the reckoning that is, it has just really come up and has been unearthed. So the Black Report just dispels all the myths and gives it to everyone straight. This is from us. And actually, this is the first time you hear from us in this capacity. But it's definitely because of the Mellon Foundation. I will not negate that. If we didn't have that money, we would not be in the position that we are in. But we also have an obligation, as Omar always says, to right the wrongs. And that's what we're out here doing. So get the Black Report. It's on our website. Download it. You know, read about the companies. It's only a sampling, really, a representative sample of this amazing community that exists. But there's also some amazing history at the back of that book that needs to be in academia, that needs to be published widely and distributed widely to our white American dance community. So when they talk about dance, it's fully inclusive. And I'm, of course, only talking about Black and brown people right now, but we know there are indigenous, there's Asian, there's so many more cultures that need to be part of this dance history that are just not included.
Wow, thank you. And I know, and I will ask Tiffany Pittman, our wonderful marketing and PR manager, if you can drop the link to the Black Report in the chat for those who haven't already downloaded or looked at it. I would love for y'all to go ahead and cop that so that you can, you know, learn yourself something, as the old folks say, learn yourself something today. Now we're going to go ahead and hop into our game break. That was such a great transition, and we're going to get to learn more about one of our guests. I'm looking at you, Kristopher. So we're going to get to learn a little bit more about Kristopher McDowell. You should see, if you are in the room, you should see that chat coming up. Technology. I'm like trying to do both. Why are you trying to do a lot, Toran? Calm down. You should see that poll coming up for you soon. And everybody on the Facebook, you should also see those results coming soon as well. Let's get into it. Kristopher has managed the career of Molly Ringwald. Kristopher does not watch network television. Kristopher has never gotten a speeding ticket. Which one do y'all think is the lie? That Molly Ringwald, I'm like, a little stretchy, but you never know. I was like, I know you've been around, so you know, we'll find out. 20 more seconds. I'm not paying attention to Tyquil because I want to see if y'all know Chris, how well y'all know Kristopher McDowell. All right, and 3 more seconds. Let's see what the people say. All right, Denise, Francine, which one do you think is the lie? Molly Ringwald, network television, or speeding ticket?
I said the speeding ticket.
Okay.
You know, I'm going between the two because I never do hear him talk about TV. Like I never hear him talk about a show ever, like a television show. But then I'm going to go, IQL has been like pretty spot on most of these times. So I'm going to go with IQL. He said BS on the speeding ticket, so I'm with it. But you know, I've never seen Kristopher drive even. But I'm going to go with the speeding ticket too.
Okay, all right. Our in-room audience, it was neck and neck. People were split between television and speeding tickets. So I'm going to go ahead and ask you, Kristopher, which one is the lie?
Oh, it's so the speeding ticket. You know, you do well.
I know it.
but I have not managed Molly Ringwald's career. I did her music launch when she did her music career and has done since. But yeah, I've been working on her music career. So that, I just want to clarify since this is archived.
Okay, well, thank you. Thank you for clarifying and thank you for letting us know. Wow. So, you know, Kristopher McDowell's got a lead foot, just in case y'all didn't know. It's okay. It's open space, we're being honest. So let's hop right back into it. Something that we talked about, taking the money, right? So like, also we need to talk about some people who took the money and ran. You know, we had some money drop in to save our smaller organizations, save our smaller businesses, but everybody wasn't a beneficiary of that. We also saw something else, and we're talking about timeliness. We saw timely activism. Like, we saw some people who jumped in because it was convenient to either not look racist or to not look tone deaf. I want to kind of hop in and have us talk about that. Francine, how you feeling about these thieves and imposters? I don't have no better words for them.
You know, yeah, I hate to say that they're imposters, but that's what it is, you know? And to have one of the highest paid ballerinas come out and talk about racism in the field after the fact, when she is not there anymore, has really been in my mind and in my head. And at first I was like, oh wow, yeah, that's great that she's talking about this. But then I was like, wait, why didn't she talk about this when she was there, when she was going through the experience? You know, it would have been more relevant that way. But of course, I mean, we can speculate about why she didn't. I mean, I'm sure it was because she needed to keep her job, definitely. But, you know, I was like, great effort, but it's a miss. It's a definite miss. You really should have done that years ago when you were going through it, because it would have helped the cause a lot more faster. It would have definitely pushed the cause in people's faces sooner than now, you know, when everybody else is talking about it already. When we have been screaming about this for years to people and has gone on deaf ears. So I'm just like, come on now, really? Why now? Why now? I'm just, yeah. And in terms of people or organizations taking money and running, you know, these big institutions, arts institutions are taking money from the government that was really allotted for these smaller institutions and smaller companies, and really not doing anything with it, laying off people left and right and keeping the money and not doing anything. You know, I've seen a lot of stuff come out virtually from, you know, one of the biggest institutions, and I don't know if I should just name it, but they are on Facebook almost every night with some artist putting them on display. And I have always, I mean, I still don't know to this day whether they pay these people.
The Kennedy Center.
Okay, all right, thank you, the Kennedy Center. They're just not, I'm trying to figure out why? Why aren't you paying these people? Why aren't you paying them what they're worth? You know? And it really just boggles me that they're not doing this, that they're the ones who benefited from all of that PPP money or whatever they call it, and not doing any, not being equitable at all with it, at all. And I'm baffled by it, you know? And I don't have any intellectual thoughts on it, really. I'm just like, that's just effed up. And it just really, it pisses me off.
No, we needed that realness. No, I appreciate it. And I, Kristopher, I'm turning to you because we, because I think both of those instances that were just named are part of a larger stigma or a larger illness that's happening, right? That people drop statements, you know, especially at the top of Black Lives Matter, or at least George Floyd, like, you know, and even at the top of COVID, people dropped a lot of like solidarity statements that we're seeing that we don't know if they're really living up to, you know? So how are you feeling about that? How are you interpreting their actions?
Well, it's time to hold myself accountable, which means it's time for me to hold the field and other white people accountable, frankly. But let's step back, and it's sad. It's a tragedy. Columbia Artist Management is gone. That's the grandmother of it all. Like that's the reason these marketplaces exist on many levels. And they didn't have enough of a sustainable practice. And I'm not attacking Kim, because we had this practice. Francine and I had this practice. It was the model. They didn't have enough cash flow to go for 6 months. They couldn't get through a year. If that's the grandma, then we have a problem. And I just, you know, this rush to go back to the structures that are in place is just getting really frustrating for me. If you ask how do I feel about it, it's getting really frustrating. It's getting old to me, so I can't even begin to imagine how old it is for the majority of others attending this conversation right now.
Mm-hmm. And now I'm looking at Denise, because I know in staff meetings and in personal meetings, you have been a large component. You've been sick and tired. I think there's some less eloquent words that you've used, but I use the, you've been sick and tired of these kind of happenings. I would love to hear your thoughts about what's going on in this craziness.
Yeah. Well, you know, the Kennedy Center. So let's just stop there for a second. I'll tell you what I did. I use Facebook. So there you go. And probably a month ago, I received a mailer from the Kennedy Center. And the mailer is the typical mailer that I have been receiving from that organization for probably, let's see, I moved back to Washington, D.C. in 1997. So how many years is that? That's how long I've been receiving that mailer from the Kennedy Center in the same envelope with the same four little bookmark cards that have artists of some sort on them, on the same brown paper that's supposed to replicate a ticket. And I was like, in the middle of a pandemic, y'all are sending me some, y'all are sending me this same ish. Isn't anybody talking in your organization about what's happening right now in our community? Particularly when you all just rolled out a Black man on video talking about the change y'all were getting ready to go through.
Thank you, because I was about to bring that up.
Okay.
Like, what happened to that? What happened?
The social impact, you know? And I know we all have to eat and we all have families. I get that. But at some point, it's like, really? Usury. Who are you talking to? How are you trying to, what are you all saying? What are you all doing? Because the right hand is not talking to the left hand. And so I went on Facebook and I tagged the Kennedy Center and I was like, what the hell? What is this? And it got to the Kennedy Center and I got an email and a call. Thank you for calling us out. We're working on it. You know, the pacifying language. And when I responded with my story, they didn't respond back. So I said, well, there's that. And don't you know, when I went to the IABD office about a week ago to get the mail, there was that brown envelope, the white envelope with the brown ticket and the four cards and the, you know, please become a member. No change. So I'm back to that same thing I said earlier, Toran, systems change. So Francine, like, I don't know what they're doing either, but they're not doing the right thing.
They're not doing the right thing.
They're not doing the right thing.
When I first saw that, okay, so I'm about to put the video that what's his name is on talking about this social change. I'm going to put it in the chat. Okay. When I first saw it, I was like, oh, wow, this is amazing. Because remind me of the guy's name. I don't remember.
Mark.
Yes.
I'll just say his first name, Mark.
So when I saw that it was him on this video, I'm like, all right, they are like really, they're really going to do something. And I've been waiting and waiting and waiting for this to happen, and nothing happened, you know? And I was like, Mark, he's all about it. He's down. He's conscious. He woke. He doing all of this and all of that. And I'm like, damn, they got you with the money, bro. They got you.
Yeah.
So yeah, that it was just, I'm very disappointed.
So we got to create our own.
Yes.
And you all are doing that. You and Kristopher, you've joined forces. You're doing that.
Yep. That's it.
Woo. I don't even know where to go. I'm just gonna take a sip right here real quick. Yeah. the systems ain't changing, you know, excuse my French, they shit change, you know, like we, you know, how it's crazy to be in this time, right, of so many changes, and we're facing another change in this country, right? We're about to shift leaders, or so we think, who knows, you know, I'm gonna knock on this wood desk tomorrow, you know. How we have to envision ourselves forward, right? We have to envision, and I know both organizations specifically are working to create better systems and models for this field. I wonder if you could take a chance to dream with me for a second. How do you kind of envision a better arts field where people aren't taking the money and run, where Black and brown institutions are actually important and not just in some linguistic value, you know, where it is an equitable world? How do you kind of see that forward? And how are you all taking those steps forward?
I just need to, I put it in the chat, but those who don't see the chat inside Zoom, Denise nails it right on the head when she says the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. I don't mean to talk about that institution, but let's go macro with that for a second. That's strategic. That's strategy. And that has to be corrected. Because as long as that happens, silos are encouraged. And that's the beginning of another thing that I won't go into.
Oh, Kristopher, you got me in my feelings. Mm. Wow. That's so true. So true.
So how do we bridge that communication gap, right? If the left hand and the right hand are talking, how do we meld those worlds, right? Or how at least force them, because we're bringing everybody to task. So it's like we got to bring both hands to a shaking place.
Have to. And, you know, it's so hard because, and I've heard Denise say this before, it's like, you know, we're tired. We are tired of trying to bring these people together. You know, we're tired of being the go-to. I was talking to a friend of mine who is in the real estate business, and even in her world, she's the only Black person in her office. And in her world, she's the go-to for her white counterpart to come and say, what should we do about this? And she's like, yeah, I'm tired. I'm tired of trying to help you. I've been helping you. And now it is time for our white counterparts to own their stuff and really figure out how to work it out amongst themselves, or, you know, work it out, just acknowledge it, you know, just acknowledge it and say, yes, we see what's happening. We know what's happening. Let's try to fix it. This is, it's really tiring for us to try to do it all on our own. It can't happen. We need that help from our white counterparts to be able to do that. We cannot be the ones leading it all the time. It doesn't work.
Yes. And I think even when you talk about from your counterparts, right? Because there's that fine line between allyship, right? And like there's a performative nature of allyship, and then there's kind of being a co-conspirator, right? So like, you know, allies will definitely sit on the side and cheer you on, and sometimes just watch you get arrested, versus like your co-conspirators are willing to be a shield or be an actor contributor to that, you know?
Yes.
Immediately, risk. Risk.
Yes.
That when you were talking, that was just my immediate response, is willing to take the risk. And we all take it. Like if we all, we know risk is what it is. But if you are not willing to take the step, then we are not going to have the change. Everything is not going to be copacetic. We all have to learn one another and understand our differences and figure it out. But if you are not willing to take the risk, then it does not matter.
It doesn't matter.
That's exactly all we're asking. We've been risking our lives. I risk my life every time I walk out my door. Breonna Taylor risked her life laying in her damn bed at night, trying to go to sleep next to her man. Like, this is the this is the risk we're talking about. That's the world that we've got to think about and understand why it needs to change. And that's just not normal for people to live that way.
Yeah.
But in holding accountable, okay, let's go here. And holding other white people accountable, this is the barrier we run into. So it's like, oh, we're moving forward. Well, what are we moving forward to? What are we in a rush to move to? We want to go back? And again, what I see is the answer is in inviting everybody to the table. The answer is not in siloed conversation. I know I'm repeating myself, but I had to chime in with that.
No, the concept of coming together is difficult for people because we are not willing to lose what we already have.
Yep.
We're not. Many of us are not in that state of mind or are in that mindset. The larger picture is not really clear for many. And so it's difficult to shift and to see the change that we artists see and all the possibilities. I mean, I say this every day. I am so blessed. We are so blessed to be working in a field and doing what we love to do. Go to work every day doing what we are placed here on this earth to do. And some people are not, and they make it miserable for us because of that.
Yeah, it's so true.
But it's the risk that we're willing to take, because a lot of people cannot operate in that way.
So it's interesting that you say that it doesn't need to be copacetic, because that's it. It's like, okay. Christopher's really holding everybody accountable now. Well, that's okay. We can push on each other and grow. And I guess that's the resistance that I'm feeling from mentors, frankly, from within that community.
This is a lot.
This is a lot. Every time.
We we gotta take a break. We gotta take if anything, so I can get something more in my cup. I think I need something stronger at this point. Let's jump to our game breaks with our last guest. Let's hear about Francine. If you're in the Zoom room, we're gonna go ahead and launch that poll. And if you're on Facebook, go ahead and check the comments for the answers. All right, Francine Sheffield. Francine says that she has never been to Greece. Francine says that she once danced for David Rousseff. Francine was born and raised in Virginia. Which one do y'all think is the lie? Even you even got a quail saying, wait a second, look, this one might be deep. This one might be deep. I also need, look, if y'all haven't been paying attention to this chat been on fire. Folks have been blowing in.
I love my open space, folks. They know how to bring it.
I'm going to take that emotional labor tax and add it to all my invoices, Indira.
Yes, Indira, good line. Yes.
Oh, wow.
Can you send me the template, please?
Okay. Oh, look. All the way. Let's go ahead and talk about these results. All right, folks are saying Greece right now. Kristopher and Denise, which one are you leaning towards? Greece, her dance career, or Virginia?
Well, I know Virginia already. Rousseff or Greece? Okay, I'm gonna go with IQL's pick again because he's been right. We could. Hey, we're gonna go for two. All right, come on, IQL. I'm rolling with number one. Never been to Greece.
Kristopher, what you got?
Yeah, I definitely with Greece. Yes.
Francine, would you go ahead and inform the people?
What's the lie? I was born and raised in Virginia.
Really?
Damn, I'm a Jersey girl. Born and raised in Jersey, Newark. Represent.
Okay. Look. They broke your streak. The Facebook community, I'm going to shout out to the Facebook community. They knew the truth. They said Virginia. So they knew. Dang. Come through Jersey. If you out there in the Facebook world, or you in the Zoom room, and you from Jersey, stand up. Right.
My daddy was from Jersey.
That's right.
My daddy was from Jersey. Oh wow. All right, that quail. You broke the streak, but that's all right.
It's been broken.
I love you.
Live in Virginia now. This is where I live now. But I was born and raised in Newark, New Jersey.
That's where my dad's from.
And nothing wrong with that.
Really?
Newark. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow. See, look, y'all got some connections. Yeah. Now I want to kind of bring us back in, but I want to kind of shift gears. We've been talking about doing the work, right? We've been talking about being on the battle lines. We've been talking about being on the, we've been talking about challenging the systems. But part of that challenging the systems is we have to challenge ourselves. We have to kind of challenge our own practices. We have to challenge some of the own foundations and things that we've set up for ourselves. And one of those things that we don't often do is talk about rest. We don't often talk about that life change. So I kind of want to know from any of you all, whoever wants to chime in first, what are some conscious life changes that you've made during quarantine?
Okay. The biggest life change for me is that my husband and I was able to save up some money, like a substantial amount of money, thanks to the government, and put down a down payment on a house. So we're gonna be homeowners, y'all.
Inferencing some hand claps for that. That's amazing. That's awesome to hear.
Yeah, we're building a house too. It's not just, we picked a house. We are actually building it from the ground up, and it's a real process. I really feel like I'm on HGTV. So it feels great.
And that's in Virginia, right?
Yep, in Virginia.
So open space closing party in Virginia 2021.
Calm down, we'll have space for y'all.
Y'all heard it, from when this COVID thing clear up and we can have more than 10, 15 folks in a space for the party, Francine's house. Denise, what have you been doing? I know you've talked about a lot of changes and a lot of pivots you've had to make.
Oh man, my staff keeps me on my toes. Look, giving honor to God and my staff. There have been some moments during COVID, good and bad, like bad, ugly, cry, just snotty, woo, just, you know, some real life, okay, I effed up, I own it, and I thank you for your patience and for still trusting me and for still loving me for who I am with my staff. Then there's also been my family and my home life and just reconnecting with my 13-year-old child and now doing homeschooling. But there's really, I think for me, it's just been continuing to interrogate myself and the desire to be a better person and a better leader. And I've really just honed in on that. And I'm just, again, grateful to the team that is IABD and the family that supports me. And those have been like the real big things for me. I've been being a little bit more conscious with my health, for sure. Like everybody else, I thought I was going to drop all of these 50 or 60 pounds that I need to drop during COVID. It ain't happened. But I'm taking better care of myself. And trying to get rest. Right now, it's a little tough because where I'm in, trying to get my 990s and audit done before November 15th. We delayed it because of all that was going on. But those have really been the big things for me. I'm really grateful. I'm really grateful for the continued interrogation and me really just wanting to be a better person, the evolution of DST, as we say, it continues. And I'm grateful to those who are here through it all.
This evolution of DST, that sounds like a book that you need to be writing. Your next book after the Black Report, Evolution of DST. Kristopher, what have you been doing for yourself? What's been shaking and moving for you?
Okay, so those of you who know me well, I'm about 170 to 190,000 miles a year. So this has been a real struggle. I'm not used to being in the same bed. I like it now. I didn't know if I liked it for a while. I'm also single with no kids in a city that I'm fairly new in. So I am grateful for these communities, the artist connectivity conversations, and the opportunity to talk to people outside my small circle, which I'm also grateful for within Houston. But I think that what I've learned and what I've needed to do as an individual is to go pretty deep with meditation practice. And that goes right into the core of what Denise is talking about. And I have doubled down on that practice, and it's a big morning routine before sunrise, and that's never been my life before. But it's something that I live for now, and I'm very grateful for that time and that self-check all the time. And then it's also been a huge epiphany. You know, I love what I do. I work all the time. So I've committed to a 36-hour technology break starting in March. That has totally changed my life.
Wow, that's great. I think we all need to take some lessons from that. Technology break is so real.
It's so real.
I at least try to do that on Sundays. I'll be like Sundays from like the time I wake up at least till 12 midnight. 12 midnight! At least I can say I made it throughout the day without some technology. But that 36 hours, wow, that's impressive. So for all you in the open space world, we had the guest provide us with some memes, some content that was really driving them through quarantine. So I think we want to share a couple of those and have them talk about them, you know, or at least have them respond to them as they shared them. All right. If you're looking at the screen, this first one, Lord, this fly has become an internet sensation. Said, I ain't mean to land on his head or nothing, but since I'm here first, give it honor to God who is the head of my life. Lord. Yeah, I don't even know.
Just let me tell you something. I cracked up for like an hour the other night. I saw that. Who is playing? Oh, that was hilarious. Hilarious.
Francine also said this, so I was like, y'all must have played this. Both of y'all was like, this fly.
That's so funny. Wait, Denise, you sent it too? Because I sent it this morning. I was like, I love this.
Oh, I love it.
Let's go ahead and check in with that next one, because that next one was super real. Pence, all President right. Trump had Jewish grandchildren. Me, slave owners have black grandchildren. Come on, Thomas Jefferson.
Hello.
Hello. I'm going to lead out where it's at. Y'all know the truth out there. I'm dead. Look. Girl. Look. And you know that's a real phone call. You know they always like, y'all watching, are you watching this foolishness?
Iquil, I got you coming. It's coming, Iquil.
That's funny.
I know Joe hopped on the phone and was like, I told him to shut up.
Okay. They were like,
yeah, we saw you. Ooh. Go ahead, Big Joe. They was hyping him up.
Oh my goodness.
Hop into that next one.
Yes, this right here.
The right wing heritage, let's zoom in so y'all can make sure you read it. The Right Wing Heritage Foundation, after examining 36 years of mail-in ballots, only found 1,285 cases of voter fraud out of the nearly 2 billion votes cast at a rate of 0.0000007%. That's about the same probability as being hit by an asteroid. Wow.
So, you know, let's stop with the election. Let's stop trying to hike it, you know? Right. Yeah.
We need to get ourselves together. I'm done. Look, I'm walking off screen. Look, for all my Game of Thrones fans out there, please tell me y'all feel it.
Oh, man. That's funny.
Tell Trump it was me. Look. All right, rest in peace, RBG, man. She's such a great change agent, you know, going too soon. wow. Look, sorry for the kids out there, but you learn the truth.
Oh, my God.
That fly been making moves. Probably the same damn fly, too. Look, somebody made sure.
They were like, yeah, you, go out there.
You got it. Look. You did it once, you could do it again.
You could do it. Oh, wow. Her too?
Again, look.
There you go, Aquel. There you go.
They ain't playing. Look. They are that fly on everybody. That fly coming for all of them.
Wow.
This is too much. Oh, my God.
That's my favorite.
Lord.
Oh, man. That's funny.
And then we had some, you know, Kristopher also provided me with some of his favorite gifts. I love to share those because I was like, some of these I need to go ahead and add to my gift collection. You know, I like sharing a couple. The coronavirus. That racism. Look. Yeah. Scary. Look, I be thinking about this in memes when it get a little dicey, you know, I was like, that's suspense. I was like, Lord. And sometimes you just gotta zen out. You know, you just gotta find your center, you know.
Yes.
If SpongeBob didn't teach us nothing, it taught us to find our center sometimes.
Right.
Wow, thank y'all for sharing that. You know, I'm a good appreciator of some social media content. Now, for those who, you know, may be new to the conversation, may be new to Open Space, this is one of our favorite segments. This is our dance break. So we invite you all to come on camera. Leave yourselves muted so we can hear that music, but we invite you all to come on camera and just dance out with us for a second. You know, stand up out your chairs, get up off your couch, you know, get ready to move in your quarantine comfy.
All right, so what are we dancing to? I can't wait.
I got y'all.
All right. Hi, Equil. Yes. Thank y'all.
I saw some of y'all's wonderful dance moves. And of course we talked about disclosure. So I was like, you know, let me find a little disclosure dance mix in this piece, you know? So I thought about bringing that into the space. Now this is our community section. You've heard a lot from our guests. We want to hear from you all. So this is an open forum as advertised on the episodes. We want to have a live conversation with you all the people who are in the room, some of the things you've heard about some of the institutions that have been faking the funk, you know, some of this self-care that we've been talking about, some of these mergers and the work that's being done. We want to hear what you all are thinking around the work. Feel free to chime in. Bring some of that chat energy into the space. Let me know if you have.
So you can come off video, everybody, so we can see your lovely faces if you'd like.
Can I start us off? Is that okay?
It's all good. Go ahead. Hey, Shahid, Open Space alumni, former host and guest. Welcome.
I just got two quick points. One, Amber and Jay, y'all are rock stars for keeping the conversation going.
Yes, thank you so much.
And then the second thing is, I think in the chat, what Mike brought up was how much of a healing space this is, that is truth-centered and honest-centered in ways that I think I know I missed as well. And so I think this was a wonderful way to open season two with truth, knowledge, and healing that I just can't wait for the rest of the season.
Yeah.
That's all I wanted to say.
Ashe, thank you, thank you. Mike, I see you unmuted. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm going to follow up and say that I jumped into the sessions and I met certain people that I knew of, like Francine and Kristopher, but I had not necessarily had any closer conversations with them, and this was sort of like a soft introduction. And they're not the only ones that I've met. You know, I reconnected with Indira after being apart for many years via this platform. And then it ended, and something felt like it was missing from my life. And I literally started bothering the IABD staff, like, what's the future plan? Because I felt like I was missing a limb. Like, this was the thing that I didn't realize that I needed in COVID. Like in quarantine, I didn't even know I needed this. And I started looking forward to it. And even if I missed a session, I went back and listened to the session, you know, commented on Facebook. There were still gems and jewels dropped in the recorded session. And recording the sessions and uploading them later helps me manage my time and schedule. And I further appreciate that effort that the staff and the collaborators put into all of this. But yeah, I'm so glad that we're back in community again. That's it.
Fantastic, fantastic. Anyone else?
Saying hello and thanks.
This is a legend right here, y'all. We got V, Charmaine, Warren, Doc. Yes.
You funny. Hey, Francine. Hey, all the fabulous faces.
Charmaine, thanks. You've been rocking it in your own space, too. We've been watching.
Yes, Black Dance Stories.
You know, be all over my timeline. Love to see it.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And of course, Denise didn't even finish the words out of her mouth when I said, we need. She said, of course.
Wow.
So the support from IABD and the support from the community. And just so y'all know, they are trying to take this away. They're trying to invade our space. They meaning white folks. So we're, as Kayla Hamilton says, we gang up. So it's been a hard thing, but a good thing. So thank you for the support. It's needed.
No doubt.
Like this.
We got you.
Yeah.
I know.
Anybody else feel led to add to our community section before I close us on out and give some thanks?
I just want to say, and I know I've probably said this before, but here right now, I just want to say thank you to Denise and Kristopher and the IABD staff. All of you have been so wonderful. When we came to you guys with this idea, you took it and ran with it. And it was just like mind-blowing to me how many ideas, wonderful ideas. I love the logistics of it. You know, Omar is always on top of that. You know, he is always trying to figure out the logistics, and he comes on top every time. And Toran has been wonderful as just the logistics behind the scene, technology-wise. Vanessa and Tiff, they've all been there. Tiffany especially, she's like just gone above and beyond this. And I just really appreciate you all for hopping on the bandwagon with us and just taking a ride. So thank you.
I'm jumping in just to say this. I cannot take credit for this by any stretch of the imagination. This is all Toran, and it is, I put my foot in the ground that I don't do anything. I don't check them. I don't ask no questions unless Denise asks me to. This is Toran's project and Toran's baby, so this is all him.
I love it.
Thank you. You got it. All right, y'all, with a little bit of 5 minutes left, I'm gonna go ahead and just kind of take us into a little bit of thanks, please. That's how you unmute it, go ahead.
Oh no, I was just gonna say, you know, this space is healing space. It was already, you know, named that, but this really is healing space. And community is just, it's so important. And right now we still have a large part of our community that is hurting, that still is not working. These things, you know, I think about them all the time, every day. But when we come into spaces like this, just for the hour and a half, they go away just for a minute. And it's just a healing space, just a moment to just rejuvenate and really think about why we're doing the work. And I really, really appreciate everyone who is a part of this program and the continued work of supporting the Black dance sector. I don't know, I'm just really, I'm full and just really thankful, continue to be thankful. And, you know, the IABD team, y'all do rock. Y'all rock it. Y'all rock. And we wouldn't be where we are without you. And just really publicly shouting that from the rooftop. Yeah.
Well, with that round of gratitude, I want to begin by saying thank you, Francine, Denise, and Kristopher, for bringing your honest selves to this platform on this day and also coming together to create this wonderful platform for the people. So I want to honor you all in this space. I then want to honor the rock stars at the IABD team, you know, for always, you know, holding it down, keeping it going, being those pillars of the field, you know what I'm saying, making shit rock, excuse my language. Want to go ahead and give a shout out to Jay and Amber with the most magical hands that you will ever see on the screen. They were flying a million words a minute, because I know none of us talk slow and none of us talk as articulated as possible. So thank you all for y'all's work. Thank you for Diane Braden for the closed captioning service that you offered. Thank you all, thank you IABD family, and I say family intently, for being in the space with us. You know, this is the family reunion we get to often come to weekly. You know, I'm always glad to be here with my extended cousins and brothers and sisters and enjoy the space with you all and dance with you all and learn and grow with you all. So thank you all for being here together. I'm going to go ahead and talk about, we have another episode coming up. We're back. So, you know, we're back weekly every Wednesday at 5:30. Our next episode is called about inclusivity, and that us is real intensive, centering community and collaboration in the arts, hosted by Pioneer Winter, a choreographer with the Pioneer Winter Collective, and having some of our fellow artist connectivity series members join us in that conversation. Our PRC friends are actually having their conversation tomorrow. Kristopher, if you wouldn't mind dropping that information in the chat. So please also tune in for that. Mentong Guan and Kristopher have put together a great conversation on the 15th. So we wouldn't mind if you also show them some of the IABD love over at PRC. With that, I'm internally grateful. Hope to see you all next Wednesday for another dynamic conversation. And I'm gonna take us out just with one of my favorite songs, at least it's always my hero music. Have a good night, everybody. See y'all later. Hard times like, yeah. Bad trips like, yeah. Nazareth. Got us, then we gon' be alright. And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. But how must I be looking at you from the face down? One Mac 11 in the room with the face down. Yes, Demon, go, 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 go,
Been down before.